remain standing for the national anthem performed by Parker Schultz. Please be seated. Boy, can that young man make that saxophone sing. We begin the 109th commencement of Hampden Hall Country Day School with a welcome address from our student body president, Dimitri Ratner.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome all of you to this year's senior graduation. My name is Dimitri Ratner, and as this year's student body president, it is my honor and privilege to speak with you today. I want to begin with a few words of thanks. Each and every one of you sitting here has played a critical role in the graduation of our senior class. Parents and other relatives have motivated and inspired us over the last 4 years, cheered us on at Hornet sporting events, and even paid to boost the Wi-Fi at home so we can log on to our Zoom classes. I also want to thank our faculty and administration who have tirelessly devoted their effort, attention, and knowledge so that we could emerge from our time at Hampden Hall ready to thrive as we go on to our future endeavors. And that's without mentioning the letters of recommendation, college advising, and mentoring our fragile psyches that are part and parcel of the senior year experience. Or the fact that you had to reinvent the entire educational process this past year to teach first virtually and then in hybrid. We are forever indebted for all that you have done for us. And I wouldn't feel right if I didn't offer my personal thanks to a few special people. First, thank you to Ms. Mauder, my advisor since the 9th grade, without whom I wouldn't be up here on this podium. She, like all her fellow advisors, has devoted so much time and effort, not only keeping track of our progress over these last 4 years, but also offering critical words of encouragement and support along the way. I and our entire class truly appreciate your efforts. I'd also like to give my thanks to my family, who have supported me my entire life, and especially these last 4 years. I wouldn't be where I am today without you, and I love you guys all. Senior year is challenging enough under the best of circumstances. But our class didn't only have to deal with the typical trials of boosting our grades, applying for colleges, and dealing with a rigorous senior year course load. No, we had to deal with all of that in addition to COVID-19. As you know, COVID first hit about halfway through our junior year, And because of the quarantine, social distancing, and all the other measures that were needed to keep everyone safe, we missed out on a lot of what high school, and especially fall of senior year, had to offer. All the while learning how to take classes online and apply to colleges, most of which we didn't even get to visit. The reason I mention this isn't to depress anyone on this celebratory day, nor to remind you of facts that you already know, but to emphasize one important point. We did it. We went through a great deal of awfulness, both individually and as a community, yet we persevered, and here we are, all together to experience our graduation. That right there is something to celebrate. There is a quote by Robert Schuller that I want to share with you. Today's accomplishments were yesterday's impossibilities. And boy, did we accomplish a lot. The memories I've made these last 4 years are ones that'll stick with me forever. While some might not go down on my future resume, such as winning first place in a belly flop contest, we all have memories from these last 4 years that'll last us a lifetime. Memories of Mayfests and shirting assemblies and hanging out in the parking lot. Memories of having fun with friends and spending time with family. Memories of homecoming, of assemblies gone wrong, of sports games and plays and musicals. Memories of shared frustration over a pop quiz and shared elation over good grades. So when you come up here and accept your diploma, remember back to all the good times that made your Hamden Hall experience unique. The purpose of these last 4 years has been to prepare us for the rest of our lives. While knowledge of the quadratic equation is great, and our ability to conjugate verbs is, I'm told, quite valuable, the most important thing we'll take from our 4 years of high school is the skill that enabled us to overcome a year and a half of COVID. It's a skill that empowered us to learn how to master difficult subjects and navigate awkward social situations. And it's a skill that emboldened us to have a meaningful senior year, even though we lack the traditional fun and privileges of being a high school senior. This skill is called perseverance. Each of us now knows that we have tremendous capacity to hurdle any obstacles before us. We possess the self-confidence to meet life's inevitable challenges and to surmount any hardships we encounter. Now, as I'm sure you all are as eager as I am to receive a diploma, let me just end on this final note. For what it's worth, from someone who has spent these last 4 years in the trenches with all of you, who has struggled with the same challenges as all of you, from someone who considers each and every one of you to be not just a peer but a friend, I am incredibly proud of all that you've accomplished. It has been a demanding 4 years and an especially exhausting year and a half, but you didn't just persevere, you thrived and performed so exceptionally well that I'm honored to simply call myself a member of the 2021 graduating class. I wish you all the best of luck in college and beyond, and please enjoy the rest of commencement.
Thank you, Dimitri. Over the last 4 years, you've embraced school life at Hamden Hall, participating and leading not only in your classes, but also athletics, numerous clubs, and student government. Congratulations on your success, and thank you for your words of welcome. We wish you the best at Tulane University. Our next student speaker joined the Hamden Hall community in the 10th grade. Although based on her participation, it seems like she has been here forever. Ruth's teachers describe her as a true scholar. They say she is excited to learn, curious, a perceptive student, someone who loves a challenge, and a joy to teach. It is rumored that she even asked if she could continue attending class after the seniors were excused this spring. She won prizes across several disciplines at our Prize Day assembly this week. Her academic credentials are exceptional. But to focus just on Ruth's success in the classroom wouldn't do her justice. Ruth runs cross country and swims. She participates in the arts. She's active in a number of community service clubs. She tutors and volunteers. She has a special passion for sustainability, knows that she can make a difference in the environment, and encourages all of us to make change. Ruth does all of these things for all of the right reasons. We know McGill University will appreciate having this gifted young scholar and world changer in the fall. It is my pleasure to introduce the class of 2021 salutatorian, Ruth Wong.
Good morning. It does feel weird to hear your own voice coming out of speaker. Who is excited? Yeah. You are excited. I'm excited. The speakers are a little bit too excited. And that speaker's too. Okay. Relax and enjoy. Good morning, Mr. Izzo, Mrs. Lujak, trustees, administration, faculty and staff, family and friends, and the fellow classmates. Whether you are on Zoom or in person, thank you for being here today to celebrate the graduation of the class of 2021. To the class of 2021, congratulations. It has been an unusual year for all of us. Who would imagine we could choose to wear pajamas under our robes and attend the graduation from home? Thank you, Tim Berners-Lee, whoever invented the internet. I looked that up on Wikipedia. Yep, a source all teachers want you to avoid since the first day of high school. For those of us here in person, we have to wear something. Something actually nice. Put on socks, shoes, but no heels, said Mrs. Porto. And drive all the way up here with family. You step out of that sweet small steel box filled with cool air, put on mask, and look at the sun, telling yourself, how nice it is to be outside. That's what I wrote for my original speech. But you can never be so sure about the weather in Connecticut. I had a couple of jokes for the hot days and a couple for the rainy days. But today seems to be the perfect day. It's like wearing a raincoat, but it doesn't rain. White robes are nice. They're symbolic, solemn. As if we are attending a funeral or something. If you are Chinese, you'll get that. We have a lot of white on funerals. And unlike a funeral, graduation marks the end of something. It concludes our high school years and the age we could still be called a kid. But life goes on. From now on, we need to decide for ourselves. Where will I be in 4 years? I don't know. But I'm not afraid. No, I'm not afraid. I'm terrified. Looking back at how much I've changed in these years at Hendon Hall, I barely recognize myself. And that is a scary feeling, but also somehow exciting, knowing the fact that things can deviate from our original blueprints. When I first came here 3 years ago, I never thought I would love English. A past doomed to unemployment, nor would I have imagined measuring the volume of golf balls in a chemistry lab. The teachers at Hendon Hall are unique. They are passionate about the subjects, and each of them is a character. They are the ones who brought life into learning and the learning into life. My first English teacher here was Miss Manley, who always encouraged us to write, but complained with a smile that we wrote too much. I love Miss Manley's smile. She smiles every time she sees you, until you find the situation mysterious, as if she noticed something, but she just won't tell you. I enjoy conversations with Miss Bonstable and her scholarly attitude towards English literature, or literature, as she will say it. And also how she laughs the loudest. Maybe only Dr. D could compare. Our English department is amazing, with half of them obsessing over Ernest Hemingway. Mr. Sabatelli and the Cultural Fellow almost want Hemingway to be their papa, while Mr. Gustafson only considers him a weird uncle. But speaking of characters, who can be Miss Broad? The queen of calculus, cats, and quotes, whose words of wisdom had become the legendary at the school since 1, 2, 3, 4, like ages ago, which was each generation remembering her famous, "Mamma mia, what a spicy meatball." I love all my teachers, but I admire Mrs. Carlson, the greatest multitasking example ever. Teaching 3 subjects, being a college counselor, and jogging with her daughter every day. Sometimes I wonder if she has a twin sister or something when I see her on campus teleporting from one spot to another. Similarly, Mr. Greenwald, or Greeno, is always heading somewhere. You can tell from hearing his phone alarm going on and off every 15 minutes. Greeno recycles, teaches philosophy, and loves ethical dilemmas. Here is one of his favorite. A runaway trolley barrels down the railway tracks where 5 recycle bins are tied up and unable to move. Now, if Greeno pulls a lever, the trolley will switch to a different truck and hit only 1 recycle bin. Greeno has 2 options, to pull or not to pull. That is the question. The moral is, people love having more options, but not so much when they have to choose. In a sense, we'll be free after this, yet freedom is heavy. But now, I'm not scared. The time we spend all together with friends and teachers will be a memorable part for us to savor. And as much as we have changed, we turned out great. So let's try something new. We never know if we'll like something or not until we have tried it. Open the opportunities for new possibilities. Trust yourself, and as Ms. Aza always says, enjoy the process. All I have left is wishes and appreciation. If I were a genie, I would wish Dr. Hill a disco ball hang in her classroom to let light sparkle some Alexander Hamilton. I will wish Dr. Gasparo a lobster restaurant at the center of his own enormous golf course, where Miss Manley could run her ponies on the grass if Doc will ever let her. I wish Miss Azoff more tea and candies for her and her students and just the right heat in the summer. I wish Mr. Flynn perfectly roasted marshmallows and Madame Huck and Hammersmith authentic baguette and croissant at the downtown cafe. I will wish a ton of good luck and confidence to all the graduates in the audience. I want to thank my family in China, my parents, my grandparents, my aunts and uncles, my cousins, as ever, for their love and support and for zooming in at night. I want to thank Athena and her family for taking me in as one of their own, integrating my craziness into theirs. They told me, "We are all mad here. I'm mad, you're mad." I said, "How do you know I'm mad?" They replied, "You must be, or you wouldn't have come here." Thank you, Catherine, for our chit-chat, silly laughs, and being chased by Mr. Chase Dupont in the scavenger hunt. Thank you, Victoria, Carol, and Callie, Stephen, Josh Mukherjee, and Patoy. Thank you, Nathan, who will speak later, for your help and support in 3 years. I also want to thank my friends in China, Zhou Qidan, Kong Haoyu, Chen Yuru, for texting and calling me days and nights and nights and days. Thank you, Mr. Sabatelli, for reviewing my jokes. Surprise, the bits went fine. Thank you, the paid laughers I planted in the audience. And thank everyone who has been there for me. At last, I will end with my favorite quote by Mr. Zandell, or Little Brucey. "You are now released from bondage." Well, actually, we have about 4 more speeches to go. Thank you, everyone, and congratulations to the class of 2021.
Thank you, Ruth. Now I'd like to call up the Vice President of our student government, Stephen Zhang, to present the senior class gifts.
Every year, the graduating class recognizes several members of the Hampden Hall community for their outstanding contributions to the school. The class of 2021 would like to honor and thank the following individuals. Thank you. The Class of 1977 Award. The Class of 1977 established an endowment to honor a member of the junior class. The criteria for selection includes being a member of the junior class and having been re-enrolled for the senior year, having satisfactory scholarship, a demonstrated involvement in both the Hampden Hall community and extracurricular activities, and being an outstanding model for others to follow. The class of 2021 has elected to award this year's prize to Michael Fernini. The Class of 1980 Award. The Class of 1980 established a library endowment fund to honor a member of the Hampden Hall faculty. Each succeeding graduating class selects a recipient in recognition of their love of teaching and commitment to their students. The Class of 2021 has elected to award this year's prize to Ms. Dowsett. Class of 1972 Award. This award is presented to that member of the school community who has, in the minds of the graduating class, made outstanding contributions to the school. The class of 2021 has elected to award this year's prize to Spencer Chase.
Thank you, Stephen. Thank you for all of your leadership during your 4 years at Hampden Hall. You've truly made a difference in the Hampden Hall community. Wish you the best as you begin at Yale University in the fall. And congratulations, Turtle King. Our next speaker came to Hampden Hall in the seventh grade. In the ensuing years, we all learned that while Nathan has a soft voice and is quite modest, behind this gentle exterior is a gifted young academic who embraces the challenge of our highest course level courses. As is evidenced by his recognition at Prize Day earlier this week, he meets these challenges very successfully. Not only are Nathan's achievements in the classroom notable, he takes great initiative in his work outside of class. One of our faculty noted about Nathan, he doesn't just want to be a great student, he wants to be a great person. Another teacher notes, Nathan is an avid advocate for human rights and equality. He is empathetic and compassionate. On our campus, this translates to being active in athletics, many clubs, and even volunteering to tutor other students. Always looking to make a difference, Nathan, along with some of his classmates, spent the last several weeks, when he could have been somewhere else having fun, working on our early childhood garden for our youngest students, as well as creating a pollinator garden at Ely Park across the street from the main campus. Amherst is fortunate to have this compassionate young scholar join them in the fall. It is my pleasure to introduce the valedictorian of the class of 2021, Nathan Thomas.
Good morning, Mr. Izzo, Mrs. Lujic, trustees, administration, faculty and staff, family and friends, fellow classmates. It is my great honor and pleasure to be speaking before you today. Class of 2021, congratulations. We have come here today to celebrate an achievement. When each one of us came to Hampden Hall, we may have anticipated certain challenges in our path to graduation, but I'm sure a pandemic was not one of them. Now, I know this year has been difficult for all of us. I know we have each experienced moments where the most tempting choice was to just give up. I know we've all had these moments because I've had them too. Some days, it felt easier to sleep past our alarms, to take an online day for a moment of relief, to pretend that a certain test or paper simply didn't exist. But despite these very appealing alternatives, we decided to chart a more difficult course, to go to school, to take that test, to write that paper. Let's celebrate the remarkable storm we've had to push through day after day to get to this final moment. Let's allow ourselves to celebrate the full weight of our achievements. While the pandemic does not represent the totality of our high school experience, it has left its mark on us. I'd like to take a moment to appreciate the fact that we were able to safely attend in-person classes for the entire year. Many others have had to brave this pandemic with far fewer resources, and I know we are all cognizant and grateful for our unique opportunities. Missing a page here. Luckily, brought another copy. Double-sided. While we may be tempted to dwell on the losses we've endured over the past year and a half, let's remember that today is a celebration of the past 4 years of our lives. As I think back on my time at Hampden Hall, I remember being an insecure seventh grader. When I first came here, I was filled with fear. Fear of fitting into a new environment, fear of maintaining new good grades, and fear of choosing the right fall sport. When deciding on a fall sport, the greatest factor in mind was my incredible lack of hand-eye coordination. The one time I played catch with my cousin, I catastrophically miscalculated the throw and knocked over a cup of hot coffee right onto my uncle who was working underneath his car. Sorry, uncle. Out of all the possible fall sports like soccer or football, cross country seemed like the safest bet. As I eagerly showed up to the first preseason practice on a humid August day, I was one of the few seventh graders among the intimidating group of high schoolers. I felt so accomplished as I finished my first practice, running a whole 1.5 miles. We're all gonna pretend that I ran for the whole time, not taking a single break. Although I never became the fastest, that title was reserved for John Bizar, or the most agile member of the cross-country team, I developed a bittersweet love for running, and I turned out to be one of the only two seniors, the other being Steven Zhang, who decided to run this year. When our coach invited us to a preseason Zoom meeting for seniors, all two of us, I didn't know how this season would look, and neither did our coach. He asked us what an ideal COVID season, one with strict social distancing and no races, would look like. Steven and I came to the same conclusion. We just wanted to enjoy the team and the camaraderie that came with it. Fortunately, we got exactly that. Our season culminated in a scavenger hunt where different teams would sprint to locations spread out in a park to solve a puzzle for the most glorious mystery prize, donuts. It got pretty competitive. I won, by the way, and Steven over there didn't talk to me for the rest of practice. The sweet taste of victory and donuts still lingers. Through support and mentoring from all levels, administration, teachers, coaches, and fellow students, I was able to grow as a person and overcome many of my insecurities. I've watched many of you similarly grow over the years. And even though you may not have felt the pure exhilaration of winning a scavenger hunt apple cider donuts, we have all had unique, unifying experiences during our time at Hampden Hall. Disco Fridays in Dr. Hill's class that, if we were lucky, culminated in Aiden doing the worm. Weekly updates from the Turtle King. And of course, the endless all-school email chains where we would discuss the world's greatest problems. Is cereal soup? Is water wet? Are taco sandwiches? The world may never know. When looking back at my time at Hampden Hall, I found that it's the daily routines that are the hardest to forget. Our weekly assemblies where Senor Perez would sternly remind us about yearbook deadlines. Greeno standing up in front of the whole school wielding various bottles and silverware from the cafeteria, lecturing us on what we could and couldn't recycle. The lunches where everyone would pull up so many seats that it felt like we had 50 people to a table. And of course, who could forget homecoming sports games, all-night lock-ins, fancy suits and ties for semi-formal, and the magical fall and winter plays. But despite COVID reshaping these treasured traditions, we persisted and we stood together. We've also shown over the past 4 years that we have the remarkable ability to come out and help as a community during times of need. Our annual Stuff-A-Bus drives always exceeded expectations. Many students came out to help set up classrooms in the fall for social distancing. And we saved many lives from Hampden Hall's first ever blood drive, even though the phlebotomist couldn't seem to find Josh's veins. I would be doing a great disservice to us all by not mentioning our teachers. Our teachers have been passionate and considerate, and they've made each class like its own little community. Teachers, every single one of you has been an impactful educator who is responsible for how far we've come. If I were to name every teacher who's been an exemplary educator and mentor, I'd be up here for hours, so I will only mention a few highlights. Miss Wei has worked tirelessly in the Mandarin department for all 6 years I've known her, and she shows unspeakable dedication to supporting our international students. Miss Hawk, Miss Kersey, and Dr. Hill have worked with clear passion in MSI, and they were instrumental in getting Hampden Hall certified as a No Place for Hate school by the Anti-Defamation League. And I must sincerely thank Mr. Gustafson and Mr. Alexander for their close help on this speech. Please join me in a round of applause of thanks for all of our wonderful teachers. In so many ways, our tight-knit community has carried us through the past 4 years. And as we graduate and move on to new communities, I hope we will all carry forward the lessons we've learned at Hampden Hall. By lessons, I don't mean calculus or chemistry. I mean respect and integrity, hard work and dedication towards our passions. I mean the persistence and adaptability we've demonstrated. I mean the love that each and every one of our teachers bring into the classroom every single day. As I look out into this wonderful student body, I see a group of determined individuals who made their way through a very difficult time, and I am proud of us. As we go forth in life, let us take the compassion we've demonstrated over our years at Hampden Hall and continue to care for our future communities. As we part ways, let us take the values we've grown to hold dear and stay true to them throughout life. Thank you.
Thank you, Nathan. Our Hampden Hall community is made up of some of the best and brightest professionals in their respective fields, and our 2021 commencement speaker is certainly a testament to that fact. Dr. Mina Moran is an esteemed leader in breast oncology as the chief of the breast radiation program at Yale New Haven Hospital Smilo Cancer Center. Her work in the field of breast cancer research is both admirable and life-altering, especially as one of the founding breast leaders who work with the American College of Surgeons to develop standards and a surviving process for defining breast center programs around the country. More on Mina's professional prowess in a moment, but first, you should know that like many of you in this audience, Mina is the parent of a senior who will receive her diploma on this stage today. In fact, this is the third time that Mina and her husband, Dr. Thomas Moran, have attended a Hampden Hall graduation as proud parents. Their oldest child, Jay, graduated with the class of 2015, followed by son Krish in 2018. Today, Anisha will receive her diploma. All three are lifers, and Mina and Tom have been active members of our school community for nearly two decades, including Mina's service on our Board of Trustees since 2012. At Yale New Haven, Mina has worked to standardize the breast radiotherapy treatments throughout her all Smilo Cancer Hospital care centers. She's also a professor of therapeutic radiology at Yale School of Medicine and has published numerous peer-reviewed research articles, book chapters, and editorials related to radiation and breast cancer. She's internationally known in her field of breast oncology for standardization of treatment, development of guidelines, predictors of local regional relapse, and radiation techniques. For her own education, Mina received her MD from Cornell University Medical College and graduated summa cum laude with a BS in biology from SUNY at Stony Brook. She completed her internal medicine internship at Columbia University and her residency at Yale New Haven Hospital, eventually becoming an attending physician. She was the recipient of the Yale 2014 Cancer Center Research Award and was granted an honorary Master of Arts in 2016 from Yale University after becoming the department's youngest full professor. Like all of us at Hampden Hall, Mina is passionate about her teaching and sharing her knowledge. Some of her charges include resident physicians, medical students, and attending physicians treating breast cancer around the world. She is also an examiner for the American Board of Radiology and has served on a variety of medical journal editorial boards, including the Journal of Clinical Oncology. Most recently, Mina was named vice chair of the National Comprehensive Cancer Network Breast Panel, the internationally recognized organization that develops and continuously updates treatment algorithms for breast cancer to guide treating physicians, patients, and insurance players. I was astonished to learn that these recommendations are downloaded each year more than 11 million times. It is now my privilege to introduce our 2021 commencement speaker, Dr. Mina S. Moran.
Thank you, Bob, for putting them all to sleep. All right, good morning, Headmaster Izzo, Board of Directors, Hampden Hall, faculty and staff. Good morning to the parents, grandparents, family and friends. We're all blessed to celebrate this event in person today. And to you, the Hampden Hall Class of 2021, join me in giving them a round of applause. I'd like to thank Headmaster Izzo and the Board of Directors for giving me this unexpected invitation. In fact, when Bob left a message for me several months ago saying that he wanted to talk, my initial reaction was, "Anisha, what did you do?" I was so stunned that he asked me to be this year's commencement speaker that all I could muster up was, don't you have to be a graduate of Hampden Hall to be a commencement speaker? But as it turns out, paying for three lifers worth of tuitions works too. So I'd like to give a shout out to my three Hampden Hall lifers who Bob has already introduced. And move on to say that, to tell you the truth, I initially was quite nervous when I got this invitation. And even though I'm used to speaking in front of very large scientific communities, there's a huge difference between my typical audience of old, boring doctors and you, the lively but short attention span Gen Zers. So to reduce my anxiety, I told myself that I would start writing this speech immediately after Bob invited me. And to inspire myself, I thought back to the words of wisdom that were imparted upon me during my own high school graduation by my commencement speaker. And it was then I realized, not only did I not remember what he had said, but I couldn't even remember who he was. And that was really liberating. So in fact, I got so comfortable thinking that you won't remember a word of what I say that I wrote this speech last night in my pajamas while I was watching reruns of Grey's Anatomy. So here we go. Class of 2021. Today is a memorable day for all of you, and it marks the threshold of you entering the world, so to speak, a world that is filled with endless possibilities. Gone are the days of Wolf keeping you secure or Greeno looking over your shoulder. But before we celebrate you, we ask you to take a moment to thank the people who've helped get you here today. Your beloved parents or guardians who've prioritized your education and given you the privilege of this school, as well as your teachers and the Hampden Hall staff. Whether you realize it or not, these are the people who have helped you lay down your foundation over the last 4 years. A foundation that is strong and one that other adults, or young adults, haven't begun to build yet. There's an African proverb that I love that says, it takes a village to raise a child. And today, as you get your diploma, spread your wings and fly, take a moment to thank the people of your village. So for those of you who are in the top of your class and have gotten all these honors and prizes, that's amazing. I applaud you and I say, keep it up. And for those of you who don't fall into that category, I assure you, many of the world's greatest leaders and innovators were average high schoolers who commonly experienced many failures along the way. So each of you, just by making it through this rigorous curriculum, is way ahead of the curve. And how can I say that with such certainty? Well, let's look at the stats. Of the 3.4 million high schoolers that are graduating this year in the United States, you, Hampden Hall Class of 2021, are in the 1% that's going to be receiving a private high school diploma. And having been a member of the Hampden Hall community for the last 2 decades, I've witnessed the power of that diploma with my own eyes. So while all freshmen entering college have some degree of a learning curve and an adjustment period, the majority are entering college and just beginning to build their foundations. But your foundation has already begun to be established. It is strong. It is solid. Compare it to mine, for example. Coming from a first-generation Indian immigrant family of six, never having had the privilege of attending a private school, my parents, who are in the audience today, provided for their four kids with love, support, and all the essentials for happiness. But the fact of the matter was, as immigrants, everything that was new to me was new to them. And we didn't know what we didn't know. And so often, I had to figure things out on my own. And sometimes, and a lot of times, it was on the fly. So, for example, when I started preschool, my mother, who barely spoke English herself, tried to prepare me. In our Indian language of Marathi, she told me lovingly not to be scared, the nice teachers would take care of me, and that I would play and have a snack, and that I should just do what the other kids do. I have these vague snapshots in my brain of that first day, playing with the other children, sitting in morning circle, and slowly realizing something was wrong. Not only did I not quite understand them, but no one understood me. I kept repeating in Marathi, "Mala mutti karaychiye." Mala mutti karaychiye, which means I have to go pee. Of course, no one spoke Marathi, and so I did what any rational preschooler would do. I peed myself in front of the entire class. So needless to say, I've since figured it out. Not only do I speak English very well, but I've also made it a priority to learn how to say I have to pee in seven different languages. For high school, I was an above average student in a public school graduating nearly 300 students. Looking back, I had no motivation, and no one, not even my own adolescent self, would have called me smart. I spent far too much time reading novels that fueled my vivid imagination and transported me to different worlds, so much so that I would often cut class to read. Yeah, I know, I was a real derelict. And for that, I earned a ton of frequent flyer miles going back and forth to the principal's office and got detention. Oh, but I loved detention. That's where I used my knack for self-studying without a teacher to essentially coin the concept of remote learning back in an era that was pre-cell phone, pre-laptop, and pre-internet. So now let's contrast this with your stories at Hampden Hall. Within 5 minutes of you guys being late for class, Mr. Fontana has left voicemails for your parents, your grandparents, your emergency contacts, and your next door neighbor, and threatened all of them to set out an Amber Alert unless someone calls him back right away. And so you see my point. You should realize that the Hampden Hall culture and the expectations placed on you, such as being on time, speaking up and expressing yourselves, balancing your priorities, efficiently managing your workloads, being able to speak in front of an audience without a quivering voice, and being so comfortable singing and dancing, even when you don't have much talent. All of these not so minor things are now second nature and put you ahead of your peers. And yes, even your Hopkins peers. You should all be very proud of yourselves. You are all prepared to tackle your future. And that's not to say that you won't have challenges, uncertainties, or stress. You will. Everyone does. But remember that you've been given a head start in the race. Another anecdote. For college, I attended SUNY Stony Brook with 26,000 undergraduates. A state school so big that the only way an individual student got any attention from a professor or administrator was by getting arrested. My bad study habits were compounded by being squeezed into a dorm room with two girls that loved partying and living above the university football team who threw parties 4 or 5 nights per week. Freshman lecture halls that were so large they made your Hampden Hall theater seem small, and science professors who were brilliant but barely spoke English. Oh, and did I mention that the drinking age was 18 back then? So you can imagine the only thing I learned that first semester was how to get really good at beer pong and rolling quarters off my big nose to get the football players to drink. And yet, I still managed somehow to be very surprised when my grades arrived and I received my all-time lowest GPA in my life, a 2.9. I cried for days, I begged my parents to let me stay home and transfer to Rutgers, but of course that didn't happen. And the following semester, the light bulb went off. Real motivation kicked in, and with a few simple changes, once again, I figured it out. So I made a list of 6 pearls of wisdom that I'd like to pass on to you as you each embark upon your glorious journeys. And I know you'd prefer that I just text them to you and that we kind of call it a day, but that leads me to my first pearl. In this era of hyper-technology, there are things that seriously do get lost with always being connected. So I advise you, each of you, to make it a habit when someone is speaking with you to put aside your phones and to look people in the eye. And that includes all of you looking at me now. Instead of passing time on electronics, invest your time and energy in people. Invest in experiences. Invest in creating something. Don't spend all your free time on video games or TikTok. Go out and do something. One day when you're old and gray, your memories will just be certain snapshots in time. And I will assure you, those will not be the ones of you losing endless games of Warzone or watching countless people trying to copy Charlie D'Amelio do the Renegade. As much as technology has moved us forward, it will hold you back if you let it get in the way of being real. Pearl number 2. Surround yourself, whenever you can, with people who inspire you. These are the people who will change your lives, bring you up, feed your inspirations, and help you to grow, learn, and do better and be better. For me, simply moving out of that dorm room and being more selective about my day-to-day inner circle of friends after first semester of college completely changed the course of my life. Never underestimate the influence that the people around you can have on your developing person. Pearl number 3. Albert Einstein once said, "To keep balance, you must move forward." He may have been referring to riding a bike or possibly navigating life. And so my pearl number 3 is just that. Go in any direction. Just move forward. Why? Because you can't steer a parked car. And for those of you who think you got your whole lives figured out and you all know who you are, well, I say that's great, but go easy on yourselves if your plans change. It's not a failure. For the vast majority of you, your plans will change because the you of today in June 2021 is not the same you in 5, 10, or 15 years. Growing up, I hated when someone asked me, "What do you want to be?" I never knew. Finally, one day, when talking about colleges with my high school counselor, he randomly suggested physical therapy because I like science, describing it as a 4-year degree, 9-to-5 job, highly respected profession, with decent salary, blah, blah, blah. Frankly, he had me at 9-to-5 job. Though I knew next to nothing about it, it seemed like an attainable goal for my, at the time, mediocre academic existence. He certainly wasn't suggesting aerospace engineering, so I thought, yeah, I'll just go with it. And from that point on, when anyone asked me what I wanted to be, I responded, I'm thinking physical therapy. And you know what? It felt a whole lot better to have that direction. Stony Brook actually had a good PT program that you had to apply into at the end of your sophomore year. And so after overcoming the challenges of my first semester fiasco, I got very close to 4.0s every semester thereafter. And when I went to apply for the PT program, the admissions advisor said, "Mina, you know, your grades are really good. Why not shoot for an MD?" And in all honesty, ladies and gentlemen, that is the only reason I stand before you today as a doctor. There was no master plan. I just found my way. And when I went back to my 15-year high school reunion and told classmates that I hadn't seen in years that I was a doctor, the responses I got were like, "Yeah, right," or "No way." And one classmate even said, "Aren't you the one who threw up in front of biology class at the sight of blood?" That was another story that I'm not going to tell you. So, to summarize pearl number three, move yourself in a direction, any direction. The rest will come. Pearl number four, find things that you're passionate about to incorporate into your work. If you do, you won't feel like you're working, and you'll get a lot farther faster. I'll give you an example. My very first clinical research project as a fourth-year medical student was to report outcomes on a rare nasopharyngeal cancer, something I knew very little about or cared very little about, and I was charged with reviewing about 40 charts, which is really not a lot of charts. I remember dragging out those chart reviews at a snail's pace for almost a year. And at the end of that year, I told myself, "I hate clinical research." It wasn't until many years later, a young breast cancer patient that I was taking care of said, "Dr. Moran, I really want to have babies when I'm done with all this. What are my chances of breastfeeding after radiation?" After doing a literature search, I found there was next to nothing published to answer her question, and I became determined to answer that question myself. So within months, I had reviewed hundreds of charts and called hundreds of patients to ultimately publish what was one of the largest studies of breastfeeding after radiation. I tell you this anecdote to highlight that point. It wasn't that I didn't like clinical research, but I hadn't found a topic that I was passionate about. So incorporate things that you are passionate about into your work. Pearl five, always try to find ways in your life to help others. And I'm not speaking about your career path, I'm speaking about the heart and soul of each of you. Try to touch others' lives, it doesn't matter if it's one person or thousands of people at any given time. Do it with good intention. And find a way in your day-to-day life to make a difference. Pay it forward. Think beyond yourselves. Just know, if you make your life a little less trivial to someone else, you have succeeded. So find the good within yourself and pass it on. And if you can't find it, fake it. Lastly, pearl number six, and this is my favorite one. Travel. Travel when you're young. And by that, I don't mean partying spring break in Cancun. What I'm talking about is exposing yourself to the different worlds and cultures and people around the globe. And I say do it early. Why? Because it will ground you. It'll make you realize how massive the world is and how amazing it is. It'll give you perspective and depth. Your travel experiences will be woven into the mature adult that you become. But your youth goes by too quickly. So I'm trying to plant this seed in each of your brains right now. When I was young, I always dreamt of traveling. By the end of my first year of medical school, I had an epiphany. Envisioning my endless years of med school, internship, residency, board examinations, first job, hopefully marriage, kids, without any extended breaks in sight. When was I supposed to travel the way I had always intended? And how could I become a doctor and hold patients' lives in my hands when I myself had such a limited scope of life. So right then and there, I announced that I was taking a year off between first and second year of med school. But as you can imagine, I did this against the counseling of the dean of the school and the pleading of my parents and the protests of everyone else. What I did was I bought my first long-term kind of backpack, and I used a credit card with my name on it, bought a one-way ticket to Central Asia, and then I essentially spent the next tumultuous 12 months working and traveling my way around 22 different countries. It was yet another lesson I learned the hard way. Now, I do admit that was a little crazy, and in no way am I suggesting that you pull that kind of a stunt and torture your parents the way I did. But do I regret it? Never. It was one of the hardest but best years of my life, and I am who I am today because of it. I wish someone had told my 18-year-old self to make it a priority to travel early. Simply scheduling a study abroad program, an internship abroad, or some overseas volunteering opportunity during a college summer is all that it will take. It's the difference between enriching your soul when you're younger versus just crossing it off of your bucket list when you're older. And so I will end here. You can take my pearls and guard them, or you can toss them in the garbage. Either way, I know that each of you has the potential to do amazing things, not only because of the solid groundwork that all of you have already accomplished leaving here, but also because of the hardships that each of you have experienced over the last 14 months, which will always be etched in our memories and the history books for generations to come. You, the class of 2021, have endured a global pandemic, witnessed political chaos, and have spoken out against racial injustices like never before, and you have come out strong. Each of you has what it takes to be the next generation of leaders and innovators to bring about positive change and do whatever you set your mind to. So move forward, class of 2021. Congratulations. And keep working hard. Thank you.
Thank you, Mina. And thank you for making a difference in the world. I now invite you to listen to and watch a musical selection from our orchestra, followed by a presentation from members of our chorus. Thank you.
Sunsets, in midnights, in cups of coffee, in inches, in miles, in laughter, in sky. 525,600 minutes. How do you measure a year in the life? How about love?
Thank you, Mr. Harrison, Ms. Hudson, and all of the choristers, instrumentalists. I am so proud of our thriving music and arts department. Really just amazing, amazing. Mr. Harrison reminded me that three of the students who were just on this stage made all nationals. There is no other high school in the country that can claim that. So congratulations, all national choristers. We have two members of the Hammond Hall faculty who will be retiring this year, Peter Flam and Jim Craddock. Pete is retiring after 16 years of teaching math and coaching at Hammond Hall. Throughout Pete's tenure at Hammond Hall, he always put the needs of his students and the school first. His unwavering support and commitment to his students and players are noteworthy and will truly be missed. Pete is not with us today, but we do wish him well as he moves west to Colorado to begin the next chapter of his life. Congratulations, Pete. Jim Craddock, who is with us this morning. Jim, please stand. Jim is retiring after 37 years at Hammond Hall teaching, coaching, advising, chaperoning, and van driving. As middle school director Brian Christman stated recently, long before project-based learning were academic buzzwords, Jim devised countless projects for his math classes. Many of them are now famous, from building structures made out of candy and toothpicks to dropping eggs from the roof of Whitson Hall. Jim always brought learning to life. In addition to being a standout educator, Jim will be remembered for his annual Halloween costumes. Jim's costumes were routinely so over the top, creative, and clever that going forward, Mr. Christman has named the Halloween contest after Jim in perpetuity. Jim, thank you for your commitment to your students and to Hampden Hall. We wish you all the best in your retirement. For those of you who were with us on Prize Day this past Wednesday, you had the opportunity to see how talented the class of 2021 is. Graduates, you have excelled in every area of school life, in the classroom, on the stage, in the community, in athletic and musical competitions. You were challenged by your teachers and coaches, and you met those challenges. You received a world-class education by a world-class faculty. I know I speak for the entire faculty when I tell you that we are all very proud of you and wish you the very best in everything you do. Just remember, you will always be part of Hampden Hall, and Hampden Hall will always be part of you. Before the presentation of diplomas, I would like to take a moment to thank a few people who have been so helpful in making commencement such a special occasion. First, I'd like to acknowledge and thank Jim Hunter, Joni McEachern, and the entire Facilities Department for all of their help this week. Another individual who was critical in our planning was Charlie Alexander, who I would describe in theater terms as the producer of this year's commencement. We had many moving parts, and Mr. Alexander was a great help. I'd like to thank our partners at Guy Mark Studios. Guy and Mark Garino, thank you very much. Guy, by the way, who is in the funny-looking hat behind the camera, is a Hampden Hall alum from the class of 68. And you know, Guy, I did the math. That's a long time ago. Thanks also to our entire school administration and administrative support staff, particularly Senior Class Dean Kim Porto for all of her help. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge and thank the three members of our college counseling team for all of their work this year, Ms. Carlson, Mrs. Bird, and Dr. Tucker. Our outstanding administrators and educators, and our graduates certainly benefited from their guidance and expertise. Thank you. And now, for the presentation and conferral of diplomas, it is my pleasure to introduce our Director of College Counseling, Kiki Carlson.
Okay, seniors, you ready? Yeah? Okay. Uluwa Timilayan Ayobami Afalalu. Timmy's diploma is being presented by his father, Trustee Dr. Bayo Afalalu. Samantha Marie Atro. Sammy's diploma is being presented by her mother, staff, Hampden Hall staff member Vicki Atro. Devin Richard Anderson. Aiden Jude Nugent Armstrong. Joshua Manfred Baring. Maurice Joseph Barakat. Catherine Ann Bazaar. Alexandra Elise Blaze. Kai John Bruno. Toy D. S. Chowdhury. Michael Justin Coggins. Zach Winchester Conlin. Athena Maria Cummings. Daniel Patrick DiGirolamo. Woo! Ethan Michael Doherty. Ethan's diploma is presented by his father, Sean Doherty, the Hampden Hall basketball coach. Isabel Beata Dunlap. John Russell Echeverria. Mohammed Khalil El Sankari. Duncan Stewart Farquharson. Samantha Geraldine Fowler. Michael Victor Rue Furnival. Dennis Patrick Gamester. Madeline Grace Gallagher. Uhao Han. Ke Jiang. Liam John Kohler. Liam's diploma is presented by his parents, Hamden Hall faculty members Bud and Ann Kohler. Luke Michael Letizia. Luke's mother, trustee member Laurie Ann Letizia, is presenting Luke's diploma. Tian Zhou Liu. Tian Yang Liu. Xing Fei Yang Liu. Pei Un Ma. Owen McDonough. Rebecca Jean McChesney. Yeah! Spencer Reagan McCleary. Isabella Mecca. Alexa Victoria Mislow. Anisha Moran. Anisha's mother is presenting her diploma. Josh Mukherjee. Andrew Perry Neubauer. Andrew's mother, trustee member Phyllis Perry, is presenting his diploma. Aiden Chavush Nichols. Yako Manuel Pastor. Nicholas Gage Perkins. Gabriella Monet Pasticci. Dimitri Abraham Ratner. Shu Ray Ren. Liam James Reynolds. Nolan Patrick Richards. Emma Reese Rodriguez. Jackson Reed Roman. Gabriel Harrison Sabatelli. Gabe's father, Hamden Hall faculty member Arnie Sabatelli, is presenting Gabe's diploma. Yes, sir. Cameron Robert Sadock. Gino Joseph Salvatore. Parker Layton Schultz. Parker's father, who's a Hamden Hall alum, is presenting Parker's diploma. Callie Anderson Sylvie. Amandine Brielle Sime. Nicholas Ryan Solivoda. Jessica Eleanor Stanley. Mu Yang Suen. Joseph Lewis Tenedine the Fourth. Nathaniel James Thomas. Bull Ren Tien. Ruching Tien. Johar Harshad Varma. Corey Maurice Walters. Tian Ti Wong. Shu Ju Wong. Ling Xiang Xie. Man Shi Yang. Victoria Kyung Yi. Chen Shi Zhang. Stephen Ray Zhang. Xiao Yi Zhang. Ulu Zhang. Znan Zhang. Yue Zhao. Quan Zhou. Zijing Zhou. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the class of 2021.
This concludes our ceremony. If you're not already standing up, please stand for the recessional.